whole house.
Yes, we do. Good morning.
I have some cool screen stuff, and I mean, that's why I'm going to move, make sure I'm not in my own way. All right, so welcome to Ben Speech Fellowship. We're a church. We do this every Sunday at 10:30, right here in the talking stick. And today is special in a bittersweet way, I guess. It's a celebration, but it's also Sherry, my wife Sherry, and our kids' last Sunday at VBF before returning. So your last Sunday for a little while. So with that, we're going to be celebrating with them and having chicken and good food, potlucky goodness. After the service, so stick around and be a part of that. The after party will be a real after party with chicken today. All right, so at VBF during the week, we also meet on Tuesdays. This Tuesday, we're meeting upstairs from 7 to 8:30, and we do usually have our after party where we talk about whatever happened or whatever we talked about in the sermon, and that's going to continue happening. That happens at from noon till 1. The talking stick opens at noon, but we just hang out over here usually and have a meeting together. There's a cookie sign-up sheet. If you want to bring cookies, sign up for that. Also, like Nicholas reminded us, we have this service Saturday. So every fourth Saturday of the month, we as a church gather volunteers, whoever can make it. We come here at 10 a.m., bring a sack lunch or whatever, and we go out and serve and bless the community. So that's coming up on the fourth Saturday. On the fourth Sunday, we have good times of fellowship. So our fourth Sunday, again, we have a potluck meal. We're just full of potlucks right now this summer already. Maybe we'll do a barbecue this time, but that's coming up too. I just want to share that last week after church, we had an exciting congregational meeting, and many of you were there, and just talking about what the future holds for VBF. And I just feel so excited and so blessed and so confident that that Venice Beach Fellowship isn't something that Rich and Sherry are doing in Venice. It's something that God is doing in Venice, and all of us get to be a part. That's how God works. It's not, you know, those, sometimes there's the bumper stickers that say, God is my co-pilot, or it doesn't actually work like that. It's, God doesn't want to be our co-pilot. God wants to do his thing, and he has all kinds of good things, and he invites us to participate in that thing. And Venice Beach Fellowship is his thing, and he invites us to be participants in that, and I'm excited about that. So my last Sunday, sort of, is the last Sunday of August, or July, which is the 31st. But already on the first Sunday of the month, we have Wayne is going to share with us on that Sunday. The next Sunday, Carl Kromaga, a good friend of mine who's a coach and mentor to me, is going to come. And on the third Sunday in August, I'm going to be preaching, not from here, from far away, on there. Oh, so, let the truth roll on. We're still going. All right, let's pray together. God, thanks so much that you are good, and thanks so much that we are invited to be a part of your good thing because of grace, because you invite all people to you, and that's what Jesus and his death and resurrection is all about, is the inviting of the littlest, the lost, the least, the left behind to grace and relationship with you, and we just embrace that this morning. We pray you would meet us, touch our hearts by your Holy Spirit, and speak to us today, in Jesus' name. Yeah. All right, so it was the summer, I don't even know the exact date, but it was the summer of 2005 that I first preached at Venice Beach Fellowship, and it was my second time ever being here as a guest, and Ken, the pastor, had already taken me out for coffee and said that he thought I was going to be the next pastor of the church. And I thought he was ridiculous and strange for saying such a thing when I've been to the church one time. But nevertheless, I shared a passage, and it's from the book of Acts. And I've always kind of seen that as the the kind of church, it has a lot to do with who we are as a church in Venice Beach Fellowship and what Venice is about. So basically, it's from Acts. We've been here before. It's in Acts 17, starting at verse 16. I'm going to read it from the Message version. And basically, it's this story, you know, about Paul and his cohorts. After they'd encountered the risen Jesus in their life, they went around proclaiming this good news, that relationship with, not only is there a God, but relationship with him is possible in Jesus. And that going around the, you know, Mediterranean area and proclaiming his death and resurrection and then the Spirit is available to all people had this profound effect. Things started happening, and there was, you know, confrontations and good things and bad things, but stuff started happening when they proclaimed the authority of God and Christ and his love over against all the authorities that hold us, that suppress us, that keep us in chains. And so this is when Paul showed up in Athens, and he was kind of waiting for the other disciples. And Athens was an interesting, very religious place. Okay, the longer Paul waited in Athens for Silas and Timothy, the angrier he got. All those idols. The city was a junkyard of idols. He discussed it with the Jews and other like-minded people at their meeting place. And every day, he went out on the streets and talked with anyone who happened along. He got to know some of the Epicurean and Stoic intellectuals pretty well through these conversations. Some of them dismissed him with sarcasm. What an airhead. But others, listening to him go on about Jesus and the resurrection, were intrigued. Tell us more. This is a new slant on the gods. These people got together and asked him to make a public presentation over at the Areopagus, where things were a little quieter. They said, "This is a new one on us. We've never heard anything quite like it. Where did you come up with this anyway? Explain it so that we can understand." Downtown Athens was a great place for gossip. There were always people hanging around, natives and tourists alike, waiting for the latest tidbit on almost anything. So Paul took his stand in the open space of the Areopagus and laid it out for them. "It's plain to see that you Athenians take your religion seriously. When I arrived here the other day, I was fascinated with all the shrines that I came across. And then I found one inscribed to the God nobody knows. I'm here to introduce you to this God so you can worship intelligently and know who you're dealing with. The God who made the world and everything in it, master of sky and land, doesn't live in custom-made shrines or need the human race to run errands for him as if he couldn't take care of himself. He makes the creatures, then creatures don't make him. Starting from scratch, he made the entire human race and made the earth hospitable with plenty of time and space for living so we could seek after God and not just grope around in the dark, but actually find him. He doesn't play hide-and-seek with us. He's not remote. He's near. We live and move in him, can't get away from him. One of your poets said it well, we're the God created. Well, if we're the God created, it doesn't make a lot of sense to think we could hire a sculptor to chisel a God out of stone for us, does it? God overlooks it as long as you don't know any better, but that time has passed. The unknown is now known, and he's calling for a radical life change. He set a day when the entire human race will be judged and everything set right. He's already appointed the judge, confirming him before everyone by raising him from the dead. At the phrase, raising him from the dead, the listeners split. Some laughed at him and walked off making jokes. Others said, let's do this again. We want to hear more. But that was it for the day, and Paul left. There were still others, it turned out, who were convinced then and there and stuck with Paul, among them Dionysius, the Areopagite, and a woman named Damaris. All right, so another thing that I did on that first Sunday, because I knew it was my first Sunday in the church, and I had to have a shtick, so I shared a children's story, and it's a children's story that you may know well, and you may remember hearing it some time ago, because I really love this story. It's Are You My Mother? By P.D. Eastman. People know, how many people know this book? All right. Okay. A mother bird sat on her egg. Yes, this is really happening, by the way. We're reading the story. The egg jumped. Uh-oh, said the mother bird. My baby will be here. He will want to eat. I must get something for my baby bird to eat, she said. I'll be back. So away she went. The egg.
Oh no.
The egg jumped. Don't worry, adjustment is in process. I see it up there. Yeah. So, there we go. Going back. Oh. So away she went. Okay, the egg jumped. It jumped and jumped. Out came the baby bird. Where is my mother? He said, and he looked for her. He looked up, he did not see her. He looked down, he did not see her. I will go and look for her, he said. So away he went. Down out of the tree he went. Down, down, down. It was a long way down. The baby bird could not fly. He could not fly, but he could walk. Now I will go and find my mother, he said. He did not know what his mother looked like. He walked right by her. He did not see her. He came to a kitten. Are you my mother? He said to the kitten. The kitten just looked and looked. It did not say a thing. The kitten was not his mother, so he went on. Then he came to a hen. Are you my mother? He said to the hen. No, said the hen. To the point. The kitten was not his mother. The hen was not his mother. So the baby bird went on. I have to find my mother, he said. But where? Where is she? Where could she be? Then he came to a dog. Are you my mother? He said to the dog. I am not your mother. I am a dog, said the dog. The kitten was not his mother. The hen was not his mother. The dog was not his mother. So the bird, baby bird went on. Now he came to a cow. Are you my mother? He said to the cow. How could I be your mother? Said the cow. I am a cow. The kitten was not his mother. The hen was not his mother. Did he have a mother? The dog and cow were not his mother. I did have a mother, said the baby bird. I know I did. I have to find her. I will. Now the baby bird did not walk. He ran. Then he saw a car. Could that old thing be his mother? No, it could not. The baby bird did not stop. He ran on and on. Now he looked way, way down. He saw a boat. There she is, said the baby bird. He called to the boat. But the boat did not stop. The boat went on. He looked way, way up. He saw a big plane. Here I am, mother, he called out. But the plane did not stop. The plane went on. Just then the baby bird saw a big thing. This must be his mother. There he is. There she is, he said. There is my mother. He ran right up to it. Mother, mother, here I am, mother, he said to the big thing. But the big thing just said, snort. Oh, you are not my mother, said the baby bird. You are a snort. I have to get out of here. But the baby bird could not get away. The snort went up. It went way, way up, and up, and up, and up with the baby bird. But now where was the snort going? Oh, 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 what is this snort going to do to me? Get me out of here. Just then the snort came to a stop. Where am I? Said the baby bird. I want to go home. I want my mother. Then something happened. The snort put that baby bird right back in the tree. The baby bird was home. Just then, the mother bird came back to the tree. Do you know who I am? She said to her baby. Yes, I know who you are, said the baby bird. You are not a kitten. You are not a hen. You are not a dog. You are not a cow. You are not a boat or a plane or a snort. You are a bird and you are my mother. The end. I love that story. I love this story because